Shall we proceed, guys?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, Saket.
Yes, Saket.
Okay. So before the break, we focused on the basic data types like int and string, and some of the control structures also we saw. So let's continue with more on C Sharp. So here onwards, we'll be using Visual Studio altogether. So you can launch Visual Studio. Till now, we work with individual.cs files, but now with Visual Studio, it will not be individual files. We'll be working with something called as project, where the project is actually some configuration that holds the information about which all code files are there being used within that particular project. And those all files are combined, or I would say compiled together to produce one single assembly containing the IL code for all of the code files which we have in that particular project. That helps in maintaining and managing the complex applications pretty easily. Okay, so here we have the startup screen of Visual Studio, where we have the option directly available for creating a new project. Let's use that. Everybody got the screen?
It's still launching. Yes, got it.
Yeah, usually if you're launching it for the first time, it takes a little while. Yeah, so once you say create new project, this is the screen which you will be landing on. Here there are three drop downs to allow us to select what type of project we are looking to create. This list may be empty for you guys because you have not used Visual Studio as yet. I keep on using it, so I get some frequently used items over here by default mentioned. So we'll directly head on to this section where we have the choice of languages which we can use to code for .NET. We can see C Sharp, C++, F Sharp, JavaScript, Python. Then query language. Query language is something if you are creating a database project for SQL Server. Then we have TypeScript, Visual Basic, and the UI language is there, that is XAML. Our choice is definitely going to be C Sharp here. Platform, we are going to select as Windows. And the project type that I'm looking for is console application to start with. So once you select console here, only two templates are displayed here. Yes?
We got three, but yeah.
Can I get to know what is the third option you are getting?
Workflow console application.
Anyways, that's not the case that we are going to use. Are you getting these two templates?
Yeah.
Out of those three?
Yes.
There are two options here. One is console application, which can be running on Linux, macOS, Windows, console, and the application language is going to be C Sharp. The second one that we have is having the tags as C Sharp, console, and Windows. Means it can run only on Windows. The difference between the two is this console application, the first one is targeting .NET Core, and the second one is targeting .NET Framework. What is the difference we discussed?
.NET Core
framework is a Windows only framework, and .NET Core is
cross-functional,
cross-platform. So we'll be going with .NET framework, the second option that we have, console app.NET framework, and then click on next. Project name we'll give as cs_demo. Let's name this as methods. So precisely here we are going to see the use of subroutines and functions, but with an object-oriented terminology, the subroutines and functions are collectively called as methods. I call the demo name as methods, and here I change the location to the same one where I have been creating the earlier demo. So it's D drive, desktop backups, desktop with March 21. Then we have Providence demos and select folder. So this is my target location. In this folder, it is going to create another folder by the project name automatically. And then say create. Here you can see the target framework version. Using this current Visual Studio, I can create .NET application right from .NET 2 to .NET 4.8. This list entirely depends on which all versions of the SDK, the .NET SDK, have been installed on your machine. Right? So I'll go for the latest one, .NET framework 4.8, and say create.
The latest version which we have is 4.7.2, so it's possible that
that's
is.
Okay. That's okay. Okay. Now have a look at the program.cs file, which by default comes with some using statements. There is a namespace with the name of project already. There is a class named as program already. Static void main with string arguments already there. If you go to the window titled as Solution Explorer, if not visible, you can take it from view. First option itself is Solution Explorer. What do you see there? What is the first entry with the Visual Studio icon? It's the solution file, which is usually a simple text file that contains information about the projects which you have into your solution, where the project basically is a logical unit that contains the related components created into it. That project is compiled to one assembly. And your actual enterprise project may be comprised of multiple such C# projects into it. Okay, the solution knows about all the projects. Here, currently, we have just one project. The icon C# says that it's a C# project. The extension for solution file is SLN. The extension for C# project is CSPROJ. Then, here you have some properties option within which you have a .cs file named as assemblyinfo.cs. The contents of this file will be directly put into your assembly metadata, that is what we discussed as manifest. Okay. Like assembly title, description, configuration, company responsible for creating this assembly, product name, copyright information, trademark, assembly culture, the language basically, and then the ID of the assembly, assembly version, assembly file version. All these are metadata entries. Whatever changes you make here, that will directly affect into the manifest. Then we have a section called as references, where usually whatever the other dependencies that you might be using in the project, you will be adding over here. So this is a topic we will be discussing in a later session as well, as we are going to work with multi-project solution also. So there we will discuss about it. Then we have the configuration for the application. In web application, this file is named as web.config. For any other application type, this config file comes with the name app.config and cannot be changed. If you change it, it won't be processed. any startup configuration that you might want can be placed over here, like environment variables, like application settings, connection strings to be able to connect to the database, and so on. We are going to see the use of this also in the upcoming sessions where we discuss about the databases. Then we have program.cs, which is this file.
Hello, Saket.
Structure is already. Yeah, any question?
Yes, Saket, like I have a meeting with the IT person now. I'll be back in a minute.
Okay, no problem. Okay. So structure is all ready. We just need to start writing the code, whatever we are looking for over here. So let's say here I'm looking for some helper method to be created. Something. Like here, if I have a private variable defined at the class level, maybe I make it static as well because I'm going to use it in a static context like main. Main is a static function. And let's say the variable type is int. Let's say the name is num1. Way I have another variable over here, which is also static, int num2. Okay. Just a moment, I'll be. Okay. So here we have the couple of variables. I want a subroutine to be created, something called as void function in terms of C and C++. But here we simply call it as method and object-oriented terminology. I create that. So let's say it is public void get data, or maybe I call this as get input. This function is responsible to take the input for these two values. Hence, it doesn't return anything. Here, now every one of us can actually leverage from the static input. We can say using static system dot console, and then here I can say write enter first number and then I can say num1 is equal to, I'll make this method also as static so that I can access the static members of the class. Say num1 is equal to int dot parse read line. I repeat the same thing for num2. Okay. One more variable I'm going to have here. Private static string OP for operator, where I say write enter the operator. Plus, comma, minus, comma, asterisk, comma, slash. And I take the input in OP. Here I simply say read line. I get this function, get input, called over here. Void function doesn't have any return type, so I cannot assign the result of get input to anything, as there is no result going to be returned, right? Now to provide the actual operation, here I create some helper functions. Private let's have a small modification here. I'll say this is float instead of int, as there will be a division as well. I want the decimal numbers. This also I change accordingly. Float.parse. Okay, and then the function private float add. I already have the data to be operated on over here, so I don't have any parameters, but I do have a return type. I make this function also as static. And there I say, simply return num1 plus num2. Same way, I create three more functions for the other three arithmetic operations. I copy and paste that, change the name to subtract, and here I say return num1 minus num2. Again paste, name this to multiply, change the operator to asterisk, and one more time I paste it, and rename this to divide. Replace the operator with slash. And then I create a public method which is also static, that also returns me float. Named as doCalc. No parameters. Here I will have logic of switching. So I go for switch. On what? On up. I don't want any default case over here. So I just rename this to case. Here I say return add and then break. In fact, because of return statement, break is not required. Return is as good as break. So I just remove break from here. Then I say case minus return. Yes, asterisk, return, multiply. Yes, Ash. Return. Why? Let's have a default case also. Otherwise, this return requirement will not be fulfilled. I say default. Simply don't do anything, just break. Oh, still it requires something. So maybe instead of break, I say return 0. Okay, so in all cases, there will be something returned. And then here, I say, write line. String interpolation operator dollar with double quotes. In curly brace here, I say num1 space. In curly brace, I say op space. In curly brace, I say num2 is equal to, in curly brace, directly I call docalc. Whatever the value gets returned, it will be displayed over here. And then, because it's from within Visual Studio, I'm doing this. Here I need to say, after showing the output, just wait for user confirmation before removing the console. So I put a read key statement as well. Just like in C, C++, we put that get ch. Correct?
But where is like OP, don't we need to send it into docalc?
We are already taking it as input over here in the get input, right? And it's already available within the static member. So docalc is directly reading from here.
Okay.
Right? So if you want, you can send it as a parameter also. The logic will change a bit in that case. Okay?
Yeah.
Let's start and test this. Just click on start button or press F5 function key on your keyboard. That's something what we call as start with debugging. If breakpoints are there, those breakpoints will be entertained. And we will have a complete debug session with line-by-line execution. Say first number is 20, second number is 10, operator is plus. I get the result. I run it again. 20, let's say 10, operator is minus. I get the result. Test it again. 20, 10, operator is asterisk. I get the result. And one more time I do it. 20, 10, hash. I get the result. And let's test for some wrong input. 20, 10. And if I say it's dollar, it simply says result is 0. I can make it more condition based as well, right? I can throw exception as well. So instead of return 0, I could have said throw new invalid operation exception with whatever message I want. Invalid operator entered. But in that case, here I would require the method to be called within try catch block. Right? Cut these two lines. Say try. Within try, I put the calls to those two methods. In catch, I catch invalid operation expression exception as ex. And here I say write line ex dot message. Any other exception is there of type application exception. Catch it here and say write line. X dot message here as well. And if any other exception of any other type is there, go for another catch block. The exception of type exception, where exception is the top level base class of all exceptions in .NET. Something similar you must have seen with Java as well, right? Try catch block.
Perfect.
And what is the order of the catch blocks? Specific to generic or generic to specific in Java? I mean, the first catch block you put here, how Java configures it, specific exception first, then the generic one, or generic first and then specific one?
Specific first, I guess.
So it is exactly the same rule here as well. Okay. Invalid operation exception inherits from application exception. Application exception inherits from exception. So top level class should come last. And then if you want to perform any cleanup operation, we do have finally block as well, which is guaranteed to execute whether there is an exception or not. So this is only for our understanding I'm putting here. I just say write line. Cleanup. Only for our understanding. Here I go and start. I give the correct input. I get the result and the cleanup message comes. This time I again start. I give some unacceptable operator over here, say at the rate. It says invalid operator entered because of the invalid operation exception being thrown and being caught over here and showing the message. And then here also I got the clean. So that confirms finally is working every time. So nothing new as such. Try catch block, try catch finally is working just the way how it works in Java also. Most of the modern object-oriented programming languages use the structured exception handling this way only. Do you get that?
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Hello, I have a doubt.
Yes.
Why is the read key function being called?
Okay. Let's comment this and run it once. You'll get your answer. Oh. Was there any crash? No. Everything seemed to be working, but I couldn't see the output, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So what read key must be doing?
Printing the output.
No, no, yeah. No. It is just keeping the console waiting for some input from the user. Okay. So when it is waiting, the console is visible, right? It is keeping the console occupied. It is not letting the main thread complete. And if main thread is not completed, your console window will not be closed. Right?
Okay.
For the similar reasons, we use the getch in C and C++, isn't it? Usually required when we are running the application from within the editor or from within the IDE.
Okay.
If you are running it directly on console, you don't need this. Okay. Clear?
Yeah.
The moment I get it back, again I give some input. It's just waiting. It's just not going anywhere until and unless I don't press some key on the keyboard. Once I press some key, then it gets closed because read key has completed and there is no more statement after it. The main thread automatically gets killed, which kills the console session also.
Okay. But yes.
Yeah. Any other questions you have? Now, if we want to classify subroutine and function, which of these things you will call as subroutine and which of these things you will call as function? So let's start from here. What is this? Get input. Is it subroutine or function?
Function.
No, it's a subroutine. Because it's not returning anything. See how it is getting called. It's getting called in main, get input. So practically it is as good as the code of the get input function being written directly here instead of writing it in the function. Okay. Just that if the same job I want to get done multiple times, instead of writing the code directly every time, I can put that in a structure which can be identified by name and can be called whenever required, just like I have called it here. Got it? This kind of functions are called as subroutine. So your answer was also correct. It is a function only, but as it doesn't return anything, it just performs some operation and returns. There is no return statement required. And even if there is a return statement, it will be an empty return statement like this. Which means whether it is there or not, it will not make any difference. I'm not returning a specific value. These kind of functions are called as subroutines. So it's just a classification. Do you get that? The term subroutine is actually used in procedural programming, like C language. But the same thing is called as method in object-oriented programming languages. Get that? So here onwards, we are going to call it as method. No subroutine, no function. Sorry. Do you get that?
Yes.
What is this add? Subroutine or a function?
Function.
And why is that so?
It's returning.
Returning a value. So again, function is a term that we refer with procedural programming like C language. Whereas in object-oriented programming languages, it is again called as method only. Do you get that? Yes?
Yes.
Can I put the same thing here for subtract?
Yes.
Multiply? Right. Do cal. Yes. What about main? First of all, it's an entry point. This is where my program starts. Then, subroutine. It's a void function, right? It's called as subroutine. But again, when it comes to object-oriented languages, it is method only. Main method. C# is pure object-oriented programming language, just like Java. So in any object-oriented programming languages, there is no place for the terms like function or subroutine. In object-oriented programming languages, these things are collectively called as methods. You get that?
Yes.
Okay. Now, suppose I want to have this value assigned to a variable first. Would I say something like this? Float result equals to do calc, and then instead of do calc being called here, I pass result. Is this valid? In fact, this is what we will be doing, right? Right?
Yeah.
Let's have a quick test over here for one of the operations. Go for multiply. Is this working? But if do calc is already having its return type, should I actually worry about what is the data type of this variable? Don't you think it will be wastage of time? Because if this function is written by someone else in some other class library program, DLL, right? I'm just calling that functionality. Don't you think it would be wastage of time for me to find out what this function is returning?
Yeah.
Can't we let this particular job to the compiler itself? Because compiler anyways is going to see what this function is, what is its return type. Can't compiler get this data type assigned for me or discovered for me? C# makes it possible. I just say, instead of float, it is var result. Let's test this first, whether it changes the behavior. I'll go for multiply again. It's just working. If you hover on result, it shows you result is of float type only. How come it knew that it's a float? I didn't give anything here. From metadata of this function, it came to know that the function returns a float. So if this function's result is being assigned to this variable result, then its data type has to be float only. Yes or no? Yes or no? Our job becomes easy, no? I don't need to read any documentation. Let the compiler do that job. My coding becomes fast. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. So this feature is something what we call as type inference. Why type inference? Because it has inferred the data type for the variable result from the return type of this function. This is something which can also be called as auto discovery, auto type discovery. And whenever the variable is defined this way, the var result syntax, these kind of variables are called as implicitly local variables. Do you get that? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So any questions regarding this particular example? I hope everyone tried this. Whatever comments I'm putting, give those comments also into your code. Will be easy for you guys to refer later on. Okay?
Yeah.
Fine. So let's move on to get a new project created here. How did we reach here? File, new project. I repeat, it's file menu, which comes up with the pop-up where I selected new. Within that, I have the option project. Let's select. So we are back over here. Which template we did choose for the previous program?
Console.NET Framework.
Same one we will choose and say next. Name this as CS underscore demo object oriented programming OOP. It remembers my path that I used for the previous program. So I'm pretty happy with that. It remembers my selection of the framework also from the previous one. I am very happy with that as well. I just say create. Save. If there is any unsaved work, it will be saved. And then the new project will be created with the absolute same structure what we had seen in the previous program. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So before we proceed with the demo, let's have a bit of recap on the object-oriented principles. When I say object-oriented programming, what do we mean by object in this? Usually the definition would be real world entity. Object is a real world entity. Right? I'm sure you must be thinking about the same.
Yeah.
But is that sufficient to understand what is an object? What if someone doesn't know what is real world entity? What is entity? That might be the next question, right? We cannot say it's an object because that's what we have used as a definition for object only, right? So what is an object? How do we understand this? This is object
which exhibits few properties.
So any object has characteristics which we can call as properties also, rightly said, right?
Yeah.
Any example where you are talking about some object and it has got some characteristics? Anyone you can think of.
A pen.
Okay. So what characteristics pen will have?
The color.
Color. Type of pen.
Type probably. Of pen.
Right, whether it is ball pen, ink pen, gel pen, sketch pen, right?
Yeah.
Maybe these two are sufficient to define a pen, right?
Yeah.
You can think of a laptop computer as well, which make it is, which model it is, what resolution its screen has, which processor it has got, how much RAM is there, how much storage is there, what type of storage is there, whether it is regular SSD or SSD or hybrid drive. Correct?
Yes.
These are the characteristics. So any object will have characteristics always. One of the characteristic will be giving its unique identity also. Yes or no? Yes. If I talk about your company provided laptop or desktop, whichever has been given to you, it must be having some sticker mentioning the asset tracking number. If not, in that case also, the service provider itself has got its own tracking number imprinted on it by the name, something called a service tag number. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Correct? Why it is required? Why the identity is required for any object?
Differentiate it from others.
Yes. So we can be very specific about which object we are referring to or which object we are operating with. Am I right? Like if I say this employee is fired, which employee? I have to identify the employee uniquely. Employee with XYZ ID has been fired. Yes. To perform operations, unique identification of the object is needed or not? We need. Yes or no?
Yes.
What next? The object has
functions it does.
So can I say it has got some kind of responsibilities to serve?
Yes.
If I talk about banking object, account object, what kind of responsibility I expect? Or I know that account will possess. Withdrawing amount, depositing amount, checking balance, getting statement.
Yeah.
Right? These are all minimum required responsibilities. Am I right? So you can understand what responsibilities are, what the object should do, what we expect from that object, that type of object is a responsibility. Then we do have something called as behaviors. What is behavior of an object? I send a message to an object, it responds. Or I change the state of an object. State is represented by the actual values of characteristics and identity, right? So if I change the state, the value of any of the characteristic or all of the characteristics, the object responds to that change. That response may be sending a notification to some other object. That response may be sending the email or SMS message to someone that, okay, this has been changed. Like, right now we are attending a team meeting, correct? If any timing changes are there, say tomorrow, if I say instead of 9:30, we'll be starting at 10, and all subsequent sessions will be starting at 10. For that, what I'm supposed to do? I have to go in the team meeting scheduler. There I need to make change in the timings. The moment I save it, the default behavior of Teams is to send email notification to all the invitees or the participants, right? right? You automatically get the email containing the information that the meeting timing has been changed or has been revised. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
What is that? The state of the time property has been changed. Start time, end time has been changed. And I just save that record. For that, I might have used some responsibility object, responsibility of the object. But then that resulted in triggering some behavior. Okay, state has been changed. And it's the date and time which has changed. So I am supposed to notify all the parties involved in that meeting. That is something what we call as behavior. Usually implemented with the help of events. Right? When I do this, you do this. This behavior is something what we call as event-driven behavior. Am I right? When you click on button, something happens. What is that? Button has a behavior for click. If that behavior is not there, it won't do anything. Am I right?
Yes.
So, responsibilities, maybe methods. Behaviors are implemented with the help of events. Now, what is object-oriented programming?
Everything, we consider it as an object. Like, we look at it from the object point of view.
Correct. And what is the purpose?
Code reusability, security.
Okay, let's put it. Reusability. Second, you said security. What else?
Encapsulating
methods. Something which depends on how we have implemented the code, right? But yeah, up to certain extent, it does provide it. So let's consider. What next?
Encapsulation.
Encapsulation, what is that? Okay, no worries, we'll talk about it. What is next?
Abstraction or data hiding.
Abstraction. What next?
Inheritance and polymorphism.
Inheritance. Polymorphism. Okay. Anything else? To me, why object-oriented programming is used is not answered by anything from here. Why object-oriented programming is used is because we want to simplify the problem statement and its implementation. Do you agree with this?
Yes.
Yes.
See, bank operations itself. Any common man also knows what is bank. What is done within bank? What all operations are there when I talk about a specific type of account? If I'm owning that account, I know what that account is for and what all operations I can perform. Yes or no? So when I talk about creating a software for managing all those things, if I follow the object-oriented path, I can put in my day-to-day life experience, while implementing the same thing. I can visualize, okay, this is bank, this is customer, this is account. There is a relation between these three objects. Then account is having a type, let's say saving account. The saving account has got these operations. Saving account has one main characteristic, that is balance. Then account number is another important characteristic which plays the role of identity. Right? Visualization becomes easy. So problem statement, understanding problem statement becomes easy. And if problem statement is understood properly, then only you can provide a solution properly. Yes or no?
Yes.
If problem itself is not understood, not clear, will we be able to provide solution? Never. Correct? So that's why the object-oriented methodology is used. Take everything as real-life stuff. Imagine what that object is about, what all properties it possesses, what all functionality it can provide or it should provide, and how it responds to the events. So that defines the entire object, isn't it? Yes. Now, whenever we talk about object-oriented programming, there are four main pillars of object-oriented programming which are always discussed. We just wrote them on the previous screen. It all starts with abstraction. Next one is encapsulation. Next to that is inheritance. And then we have polymorphism. Right? What is abstraction?
Hiding the data, unnecessary data. Only the high level data is
implementation parts.
Okay, so can we say selecting the required things?
Yes.
Instead of getting into data and functionality and all that, we just say, I just select the required things in this process. That may include selection of data items, that may include selection of functionality, but I don't know how it will be actually implemented. See the abstract classes, you must have worked with abstract classes in Java. Yes?
Yeah.
What do you have there? Some data items are there, some methods are there without any code into them.
Yeah.
That's the declaration, right?
Yes.
What do you do there? Actually, what is the purpose of abstract class or abstract methods?
Just the signature.
To create the object family. When I say there is a banking account class, each bank account, regardless of its type, must have deposit withdraw functionality, get statement functionality, check balance functionality. Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Do we ever talk about how deposit is going to work, how withdraw is going to work when we talk about bank account? No, because we don't know what type of account it is. Loan account, when you deposit money, your balance reduces. When you withdraw, it increases. Whereas if it is saving account, it is just the opposite. When you deposit, balance increases and withdrawal makes it reduce. Am I right? Am I right?
Yes.
What does it mean? With abstraction, we just identify what is required. We don't do anything about the implementation, right? So selecting the required things, or we can also say identifying the required things. Creating the blueprints. What is encapsulation? This is where the term hiding is appropriate. Here we actually hide the implementation. So let's talk about the laptop as an object. You have a power button on that. You just press that and your laptop starts or shuts off. As a user, do we need to know exactly what is happening when I press this button? Is it an electrical circuit, or is there some software also running behind scenes to handle that button press? Do I need to know that as a user? If I know, probably with that information, I may try to modify the behavior as well, intentionally or accidentally, whatever it is. And it will cause, most likely it will cause the device to malfunction. So the details which are not supposed to be known by me should be hidden from me. As far as the button is doing its job, I should be happy as a user. Yes or no?
Yes.
That's why you have getter setters for most of the data items, isn't it?
Yes.
Why do you define your data members as private? So that direct access is not there. The only way to read or write the data from these data items is via some getter setter methods. Am I right?
Yes.
And because it is your code which is going to handle the input output, it can have some validation code also. If your code finds that the data cannot be accepted in the current form, you can throw exception and let the user know, boss, you are doing something wrong. This is not acceptable input. Right? But if the data member is made public, user can do whatever he wants. Yes or no? The balance can be modified by the users directly. My account may have just 1,000 rupees into it. If that balance is available publicly to me, I can directly go and increase as many zeros as I want in that balance. Is it a accepted behavior? Or acceptable behavior? No, right? That will cause lots of problems. The bank will be bankrupt. They will not have money to fund others. There will be other users of the bank, the customers of the bank, who will also go bankrupt if haphazardly the balances are being modified. Everyone will try to do that, no? And at the end, no one will be left with the money. Yes or no? That's why we need controlled access. What needs to be visible, accessible, what need not be visible or accessible is controlled with the help of encapsulation. Do you get that? There's the access modifiers which help us with that. Public, private, protected. .NET comes in with internal and protected internal also, in addition to the known three. We'll discuss them in detail later on. But yes, these are the access modifiers which actually allow to hide some of the implementation not required in a particular context. Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
What is inheritance? Ability of an object to define its characteristics based on some other object. Via some relationship. Where the relationship could be. Either. Is a relationship or has a relationship. Suppose I have a class called as engine. I have a class called as car. It will have a property of type engine into it. Right? What type of relation car and engine has in this case? Car is an engine or car has an engine? Car owns engine, so has an engine. Correct? If I say there is a class called as person and there is a class called as employee. Because it will share some of the features with person, it inherits from person like this. What type of relation is this? Employee is person or employee has person? In general also you can say employee is a person or employee has a person.
Is a.
Employee is a person. Right? So this is typical inheritance. This is also a type of inheritance, but the relation is not is a, it's a has a relationship. Understand? This is direct inheritance and this is indirect inheritance. Understand? What is polymorphism? Responding differently to same message sent in or by different context. Yes. Can you give me some example for polymorphism? I have a function display in person. I have the same function display in employee, which is overriding. The one from person. When I say person, P is equals to new person. and I say p.display, which one will be called? This is one, this is two. Which one will be called, one or two? Which one will be called, one or two?
Two.
How, Saiti?
When it overwrites, that is what gets stored, no, I mean at the right. Last.
But here I have created object of type person with the declaration on heap also of type person.
Yeah, sorry. The first one will get displayed. Okay.
That will be option one. Now tell me, when I say employee, P is equals to new employee. And say p dot display, will it be one or two?
Two.
It will be two straight away. Both sides are employee, right? So it has to be this. Now the tricky part. I have person p is equals to new employee. So first of all, tell me whether this expression is valid or not.
Valid.
Parent can always point to child, right?
Yeah.
P dot display. Which one will be called? One or two?
Two.
Here also it will be two. It all depends on what you have after new on the heap. The nearest function implementation will be called. In that case, this display is the nearest. So this one is going to be called. What kind of behavior is this? Is it polymorphic or not?
Yes.
Now suppose if I have a class maths, which has got a function add that takes in two int parameters and returns their sum as int. Then I have another add function, int add, which takes three ints and returns their sum. And then I say maths m is equals to new maths. And I say m dot add 1, 2. Followed by m dot add 1, 2, 3. Is this polymorphic?
Yes.
Anyone who says no? This is not polymorphic. Here we have clear example of method overloading, right? Overloading is not polymorphic. The reason is, see the definition we have given. Responding differently to same message sent in or by different context. Same message, this is highlighted thing. Is the message same here and here?
No.
Here it is 1, 2, here it is 1, 2, 3. Are the same?
No.
So if the message is not same, it's not polymorphism. The behavior is just method overloading. There is no polymorphism in that. So the only way the polymorphism can be achieved is by using overriding.
Saket, then what is static and dynamic polymorphism?
Yeah, so that was because of this only. Earlier we used to call this method overloading as static polymorphism and overriding as dynamic. But yeah, according to the new studies and new theories, this method overloading is no more a polymorphism. So there is no question of static or dynamic polymorphism. What's my point?
Yes.
If there is a concept called as polymorphism, it has to be always dynamic. Is it clear? Polymorphism cannot be static. So this is according to the new studies. Things have changed. Okay. Now, .NET comes in with another option for polymorphic behavior. Instead of override here, if I use new keyword to create the display function, this feature is something called as method hiding. And why is that so? Because here I hide the display method of person class from display method of employee class. Okay. How the behavior changes, see. Person P, new person P dot display, definitely it will be from person, option one. Employee P equals to new employee P dot display, it will definitely be option two. The tricky part was here, right? When we said person P equals to new employee. With method hiding coming in, instead of override, if we use new. And then here we say person P equals to new employee followed by P dot display. Here, this display function will be called from the type which is there on the left hand side of the assignment. So it is from person that it will be called. With overriding, it is this responsible. With method hiding, it is this responsible. So again, based on the context, it is responding differently for the same message. Right? Hence, this method hiding also brings in polymorphism. Is it clear? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, now let's get to the implementation. Maybe before that, we can take a break here. It's 15:35, that is 3:35. 15 minutes break. We'll resume the session at 3:50. Okay, and we'll see the demo on this object orientation.
Yeah.
Hello everyone, welcome back.
Hello.
The session. Hey guys, welcome back. Shall we resume?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so time for some demos here on object-oriented programming. We have already created the project for that before we started with the discussion, right? So here we just need to understand some of the things. So open the Solution Explorer window. Out of these 5-6 entries, which one is your project over here? Which one of these is project?
CS demo, OOP is the project.
With the C sharp icon, right?
Yes.
Yes. So right click on that project and from the menu select add and then select new folder. Let's name this as demographics. Okay. Right click on this folder now, select add, and then select class. Name this class as person. So the project structure has changed now. We have a folder demographics. Within the folder demographics, we have a class file named as person. It's a C# class file, so person.cs is the full name. And the contents of the file are here, class person. See the namespace name. From where it did get this demographics into its name? It is the name of the folder it has picked up. And by that name, it has created a nested namespace inside our main project namespace, that is CSDemoOOP. If you look at program.cs file, namespace is only this much, but within person.cs, it is csdemoop.demographics, where demographics is a nested namespace. Do you get that? This thing is as good as having a namespace over here by the name demographics. And then class person going into it. Right? So this is exactly same as what we had earlier. Either way, you can create the nested namespace. Do you get that? Let's make this class public. I want a data member for this, public int id followed by public string name followed by public float age. Oh. Okay. For now, we just have these three data members. Let's save this and go back to program.cs. As our person class needs to be used over here, I would need the namespace to be imported over here within which the person class is present. What is the name of that namespace? CS underscore demo oop dot no graphics. And then here in main, I can create the instance of person class, let's say P1 equals new person. I can initialize the data members directly.
I want to ask something.
Yes.
Yeah, you said the demographics namespace is already, it's like we created the same namespace inside the namespace CS demo oop, right?
Correct.
So why do we need to specify using CS demo oop dot demographics in this
case? Good question. Though it is there inside CS demo oop, but the main method belonging to program class, where program class belongs to this namespace, doesn't have a visibility of the demographics namespace directly. In that case, I would be required to say demographics dot person over here. I need to say, okay, in current namespace, there is a namespace demographics which contains person class. The other way around, I can put a using statement here inside the namespace also. So in that case, I can directly say demographics.
Okay.
So what you are saying is also applicable here. It's already there as a part of this namespace. So I just say using demographics, which is there in the namespace demo. Got it?
Okay, got it. Thank you, sir.
But usually as a practice, the namespaces we import on the top before the main namespace. Hence, I put the using statement here this way. Now, in this scope, the file doesn't know anything about this namespace also, because this using statement is outside the namespace, right?
Yes.
Okay, so it's all about scoping. Now here I say name is equal to James. F is for float, and then semicolon here, and then I say console dot write line. The interpolated string ID colon within curly brace, I say P1 dot ID comma name colon within curly brace, I put P1 dot name comma age colon within curly brace, I say P1 dot age, and then console dot read key. I believe this is very, very straightforward code that we have used so far. Correct? Nothing much to discuss here. We created a class which has got three data members, ID, name, and age with their respective types. Here we imported the namespace for that class, created the object of that class person by the name P1, initialized all the properties here, This is object initializer syntax that we are using, a shortcut that C#3.0 basically brought in. Okay, with the help of which I have initialized all the data members and then displaying the data within those data members here. And that's it. Any questions? Is it clear?
Yes, Saket.
Yes. Yes.
Usually, when we use this, when we're creating this person object, right? Do we need to give ID is equal to 101, name is equal to? Can't we directly give 101, comma James, comma 45.56?
For that, we do create some constructors, right?
Okay.
And with the help of that, we pass the values over okay. here.
We didn't write a constructor.
We didn't create any constructor as yet, correct?
Yeah, so usually we do p1.id, p1.name.
Yeah, so this syntax is actually doing that only.
Oh, okay.
Just that C# has made it available in a shortcut manner with this particular feature. After parenthesis, directly you can put curly braces and then property name equals to value you can put. This is something what we call as object initializer syntax.
Yeah, okay.
So it's a shortcut of the same thing what you are talking about. p1.id, p1.name, p1.h. Okay?
A second.
Let's start this and see whether we get the desired result or not. We do it. But do we have any facility to check that ID should not be a negative number, age should not be a negative number, or it should not be below 18 or something?
No.
Name should not be null. Whatever we pass over here, don't you think it would be able to take everything as correct input?
Yeah.
How do we control this?
Using constructor.
Using constructor, you said. How? Abhishek?
In the constructor, we put some like some if statements to handle the data.
Yeah, but if I don't use that constructor at all, then?
Then while printing, we can show like when we are assigning the values, we can raise an exception.
Okay. Like, so one doubt I have. Suppose this program is written by me and the person class is written by you. You are saying I should handle the exception situation at my own end. Suppose if I don't do that, is there any way using which you can force this exception handling on me?
No, I was saying we can put the exception in the person class. Like when we get the data, when it is getting assigned,
where we will put that?
Yeah, that I don't know.
See, that's where the issue is. We have the data members which are directly defined as public, right?
Yes, we need to make it right. Private.
Getters and setters.
Yes, exactly. That is where we need to bring in the encapsulation feature, correct?
Yeah.
I come in there, paste it back, and make all of them private. And then I create the getter setters of them. So for ID, I will create it manually. And then for name and age, I'll use Visual Studio to get it generated for me. So the getter setter has to be a public entity, right? Here, C# makes it even simpler. by bringing getter setters in one single entity called as property. I just say there is public int ID. Tisha, being case sensitive, is going to help me out with this. Right? This ID and this ID are going to be considered separate. Like method, I have curly braces here. But unlike method, here I don't have the parentheses to get the parameters. Here I put my first block, that is get. And then the second block called as set. This is going to serve me the purpose of getter and setter. Here in get, I can say return the ID with small I. And within set, I can check if ID is greater than equal to, or in fact greater than 0, then not ID, it should be the actual value which is coming in. So set block comes with an implicit parameter for it of this type by default. And that parameter is named as value. Okay, so I check if value is greater than 0, let it be assigned to ID. So new invalid operation exception. ID has to be more than 0.
Second, what was that value you told about? Can you say it again?
This is an implicit parameter passed to the set block. Usually your setter will take in a parameter of the same type as that of your data member, right? If you are writing the getter setter method, right? So value is serving that parameter only. And it's a built-in parameter available as a keyword. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So this is what the ID property will look like. How the program changes here. Instead of ID with small I, I'll say ID with capital I, because now small I ID is no more accessible to me. It is private. But this ID with capital I is accessible to me as it is public. Now see, its behavior on this side is just like that of a method. But when using, it behaves just like if it is just a data member and nothing more than that. Am I right? I don't need to call any method over here, which is the case with getter and setter methods. It is being used just like if it is a data member only. Correct? Correct?
Yeah.
Much more simplified. Now I want to do something similar for name. Now watch it carefully. This is my data member name. Even if it is public, let me make it back to public. Visual Studio as an ID gives me a feature that allows me to encapsulate this. See, by making them public, the error over here also is gone. Let me make the correction for ID though, because it has been already changed. Okay. I just right click on name. Just watch it carefully. I right click on the data member name. I say quick actions and refactoring. Here I have got an option, encapsulate field. Name and use property. I click on this. Directly, it gave me the property generated for this. Here it is actually making use of auto implemented getter and setter with a feature that we will be discussing later on called as lambda expression, and this syntax is actually called as expression bodied members. So getter and setter are created. This is just a shortcut version of what we did here, but this is going to work if and only if I don't have any if statement or any complex logic over here. My requirement is to check that name should not be null or empty before getting the value assigned to the name. So I'm going to change this block. Check curly braces. Yet I leave it as it is because I just want to return name. And here I say, if not string dot is null or empty value, then name equals to value. Else, throw new invalid operation exception. Here is the message, name can be null or empty string. So this is my name property. And see, by default here, it has become, the name data field has become private. And in program also, you will see, it has been changed to use property by default. I didn't make this change, right? This is where the Visual Studio helps me with the encapsulation capabilities. Do you get that? So can you guide me how I am going to achieve the same thing for age? I want age to be more than 18, more than or equal to 18. What I'm supposed to do? Yes, anyone? What I did with name? In program, it's still with the field name only, right? Here and here both. Just watch it once again carefully. Right click on the field, quick actions and refactoring, encapsulate field age and use property. It has generated the property for me. I just arrange it on multiple lines. Get, I am okay with set block. I want to sign on my own. So here I proceed. The complete if else statement I'm copying from ID, pasting over here. Here my value is supposed to be greater than equal to 18. I say age is equal to value. Else throw new invalid operation exception. I'll say age has to be more than or equal to. Now I have complete control on what data should be accepted, what data should be failing. And meanwhile, you can see age here and here has automatically changed. Right? I should write all this code except the read key thing in try catch. So here I cut this, I say try. Within that, I paste the code back. Exception is caught over here. This time I'm using only the generic exception. I'm okay with that. You already saw how to work with multiple catch blocks. I just say display the message. I've not corrected the values here. I purposefully gave all wrong values. Got it? ID has to be more than zero. There itself it failed. It won't check name. Okay? I correct the error here. I start again. Now, ID will succeed, but name will fail. It says name can't be null or empty string. Okay. I gave a valid value over here. Maybe before that, I just say empty string. I should still get the same exception message. And I say it has got a valid value. Now it should fail on age. Corrected, and my program is working well. Person class being written by me, I am forcing or enforcing all the validations also. Right? Yeah.
Hello, Saket.
Yes, Saket.
Yeah. So, Saket, a small doubt. Like, yes. we right clicked on public string name, and then we added a constructor, right?
Not the constructor, the property.
Yeah,
we constructor with property. The encapsulate field.
Yeah. If we don't do that, and if we write ourselves, will the change be reflected in the program?
No. If you do it on your own, you have to modify your calling code yourself. That's what we did with ID, right?
Yeah.
ID I changed manually.
Yes. I get it.
Saket.
Yes.
Yeah, actually I missed one thing. I'm not able to connect both the directories.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you share your screen? I'll guide.
Yes. Just a sec. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Okay. So can you go to the person.cs file?
Yes.
Scroll up. I want to see the beginning. Yeah. The issue here is you have two namespaces under CS demo. CS demo contains demographics that also contains another demographics.
Okay.
Right. So if you want to make it work as it is, in program.cs, you have to say using CS demo dot demographics dot demographics.
Here, one more demographics, right?
Yes. And CS demo also has missed one O, I guess.
No, it's in my, it's single O only.
So, okay, just check if P is capital or small. It's capital, you can see on
capital. My capital, okay, I think that's the issue, yeah. Yeah, now it's working. Okay, thank you so much, yeah.
Right, or else you could have removed one of the demographics namespace from the person's CS.
Okay, I'll do that.
Just go there.
Which line?
Person.cs file.
Person.cs, yeah.
So line number 7, there is one dot demographics that you could have removed.
Okay.
And then there will be just one demographics required.
Perfect.
Understand?
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
It's all hierarchical.
Yeah. And that's what clears to me. Thank you so much.
So just make sure everyone is done with this program and understood it properly, the encapsulation part, which we have done with the help of properties. Done?
Yes, Saket.
What if I want to have a constructor over here? I just type CTOR and press tab once, in fact, twice. It brings in a constructor automatically. It's similar to what you might have seen in C++ or Java. Access modifier followed by the class name. And then if I want to make it parameterized, I say int id, comma, string name, comma, float age. I want it to be initializing all my properties with these values. Should I be assigning it to the data members directly like this? I should be doing this. ID is equals to ID. What is correct? Line 76 or 77? Syntactically, both are correct. Logically or conceptually, what is the option we should be using?
76.
No, because our property procedure now has got some validation into it. Whenever we have such things, I shouldn't be using this. I should be always getting my field members initialized with the help of properties, so that the validations are enforced even in case when the data is being initialized with the help of constructors. Do you get that? Otherwise, you will be required to write validation code once again over here. That will be repetition of code, right?
Saket, one doubt. So if I write this dot id, like whatever is written 76, and we have already, we run it, but we have already written the, set, get and set here. So won't that take care of it?
No. This way, you are accessing the field directly. You are short circuiting the property there.
Okay.
You are bypassing it. This way, you are going via property. You get that?
Yeah.
This is the correct. Understand? What changes should I make over here? Now, this will not work because I don't have any default constructor. I have to go with the parameterized constructor here now. Person P1 equals to new person. And then I say 101. James. 45.56F, like this. And if I start, it will still work the same way. Try entering invalid values there. You should get the exception here as well, and the message gets displayed accordingly. You can try with one of them, let's say ID. See? My code is completely reused here. This is something which comes under coding practices. Do you get that? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Let's comment the code. Whatever we have inside try-catch block, save everything. And now let's go for adding another class to this folder demographics. So right click on demographics folder, add class named as employee. Make the class public. See, it also goes in the same namespace. CS demo op. Dot demographics, right? This inherits from person. So simply colon person. Okay. The employee class has got some of its own members. ID, name, and age taken from person via inheritance. It has got department number and salary in addition. department number suppose is int, and I don't want any validation on department number and salary as of now. So I don't want to have private field, public property and all that. I can get this done quickly with the help of auto implemented properties. So for that, I just type PROP, PROP, and press tab twice. It automatically creates a property, procedures and tags. It has already highlighted. I'm not looking to change the type. So I just press tab. It highlights the name of the property, where I start typing the name as department number and press escape. I have a property by the name department number with default gets set into it. I don't need to write their bodies. I don't need to have a backing field also. The system will create it for me automatically. Same way, again I say PROP, tab, tab. This time I want to change the data type, so I say type double over here in place of int. It gets changed, then press tab. It highlights the name. I change this to salary and press escape. The property salary is also created. Okay. Now, here I need to have a constructor that takes in parameters. How many parameters I would need? Do I need only department and salary, or I need all?
5 parameters.
Correct. All parameters. Int ID, string name, float age, department number, and double salary. And then the initialization of ID, name, age is already there in the base class. I don't want to write the code again. So I just say colon base and pass ID, comma, name, comma, age there. Something what we call as constructor chaining. I've chained the constructor of employee class to the person class constructor. Similar feature you have in Java, just that the keyword that you use here in Java is super. And probably it's not here you do this, you do it inside the constructor, right? Right?
Yes.
So here we have base, and it's done directly over here, not as the part of the method or the part of the constructor. The constructor remains clean, where I just need to focus on the members of the current class being initialized. So I can say department number, again the property, is equal to the parameter department number. And same thing for salary, equals to the parameter salary. Okay. To test this out, I just say employee, EMP equals to new employee, 101, since 45.56F, 10, 1 lakh. And then console.WriteLine ID, EMP.ID, name, EMP.name, age, emp.age, comma, department number, in curly brace, emp.departmentNumber, comma, salary, colon, curly brace, emp.salary. And we already have read key here. So I just say start. Working? We just saw how the inheritance works. Yes? I believe in Java, it's not the colon operator. We use the keyword inherits for inheritance, right? Employee inherits person. That's how we write it, correct?
In Java, we write extends.
Extends, yeah, extends. Inherits is in VB.NET. So it's a keyword, extends, correct? Here we just have a colon. Now, I go back to my person class, and here I add one more member, which is also public, void display. The example we discussed on whiteboard. Here I say, console.WriteLine. Rather, I can say string display. That's better. Ideally, the backend classes should never be interacting with the UI because they may get used in different types of applications. So this is absolutely wrong. Instead, I say return. Interpolated string. And I don't require p1.id. I can directly say id, name, and age, as these are all the properties of the current object only, directly accessible. Okay. Then here I make this a virtual function. Virtual means I'm giving the permissions to the derived classes to be able to override this. So in a way, I'm making this function overridable. Will be required because display from person will behave differently. Display from employee has to behave differently. For that, here I just say override, type override, and press space bar. It comes up with a list of methods that can be overridden, out of which one is display function. I just select that and press tab. It automatically completes signature. Public override string display. I delete this line of code, and here I say return interpolated string within curly brace. The first part should be base.display, comma, department number. It should be outside curly brace. The comma, department number, colon, within curly brace, I say department number, comma, salary, colon, within curly brace, I say salary. Let's save this. Go to program. Instead of this now, I can say console.WriteLine emp.display. And start. I'm still getting the same out. Similarly, if I comment this and uncomment this part, and here I say console.WriteLine p1.display, I should see the person data straight up. We discussed about this condition on whiteboard, right? Right? What if my declaration is like this? person EMP equals to new employee, all the data going in, and there I say console.writeLine EMP.display. What is the output? Expector now, just first three values or all five values? It shows me all five values. Did we discuss this on whiteboard? Method overriding, polymorphism. Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes, Akit.
Okay. There was one more situation, one more condition we discussed. Method hiding. Remember? I have exactly same thing. I just comment this here and replace override keyword with new keyword. That's the only change. I come back here. I say, this is uncommented. This is uncommented. What is the output expected? The data from person object working. Then I uncomment this. Employee EMP, new employee. And then employee.display. What is expected? All the five data members. This is something common regardless of whether you are using method overriding or method hiding. The things change when you use this. With method overriding, it displayed all five values in this condition. But here with new method hiding, it's displaying me only three values from person. That's what we discussed, right? Based on the context on which the display function is getting called with the same message, the behavior is getting changed for both method overriding as well as method hiding. Am I right? Am I right?
Yes.
So, any questions here? Just try out all the things we did here. And see if you have any questions. I hope it's clear to all. Right, so we're done with the object-oriented techniques as well, though there is the concept of abstract classes, field classes also over here, but that's currently out of scope of this program. I'll be sharing some links for you guys to go through all those features. Okay, you can actually go through the C# tutorial on tutorialspoint.com that contains all the object-oriented principles and the techniques, whatever are used, right? Because the time scale that has been given to us for this entire program is just 5 days, within which we have to consider C# basics, MVC programming, web APIs, little bit of Angular and React.js also integrated with web APIs. So we need to go a little quickly and we cannot touch upon all the topics. But yeah, wherever required, wherever I feel that, okay, this is something important, I would be sharing some links. I would be guiding you with the tutorials that you can go through to learn the other things in detail. And if required, you can ask me for the samples also. I'll be sharing the samples as well with you. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So just read out the further object-oriented features of C# language on tutorialspoint.com. Let me ping that in chat box also. Just check if you are able to access it. If you click that link, it will go here. Complete tutorial you have here. Different options, different basic features, right? Some of which we have already done, some of which you can additionally find here. Like polymorphism we just discussed. And then in that itself, we have operator overloading, working with interfaces, right? Something more on namespaces you will find here. You have inheritance thing also. There itself, somewhere you will find the abstraction. I mean, abstract classes, abstract methods, abstract properties, etc. Just go through this tutorial.
Okay.
Right, you have the options for properties as well. This is something we just used. So from this section, from advanced section, just go through properties. And from the basic section, you can actually go through everything except this preprocessor directives.
Okay.
And if you have any doubts, we can discuss that before the session starts tomorrow. So that is it for today. Tomorrow, few more object-oriented features we will be learning, mainly to highlight some of them, like delegates. Lambda expressions. Anonymous methods, events, and we'll be talking about the parallel programming. Using task parallel library, in short, which is called as TPL. Async programming. That is asynchronous programming, actually. And in one of the most important feature, the database access. And our focus will be not on the raw ADO.NET APIs. We will be actually using an ORM solution using Entity Framework. That's the major agenda for tomorrow. The detailed agenda, anyways, I'll be sharing when we start with the session tomorrow. Okay.
Yes, thanks, Akhil.
And this also I've shared so that you can do some pre-study before the session starts to make us help understand the things more quickly and little easily. Okay.
Saket, I have a doubt in this one, which yes. I wrote. So the last one was method hiding. So in that, we were supposed to get all the 5 values, right?
With method hiding, we should get only the values from the class which is used here.
Okay, so only some person.
Person, it should be 3. If it is employee, it should be 5.
Okay.
All 5 will come. Even if person is here, when we are using method overloading.
Okay.
Sorry, method overriding, not overloading. Okay?
Yeah.
So like here, if I run it, it shows me only 3. Without making any changes here, just one change. Instead of new, I use override. That is method overriding. I didn't change anything in program. Here I get all 5. Right?
Okay.
So just read more on this.
Yeah.
I hope you enjoyed the session today as well.
Yes, Sakit. It was very nice.
Okay. So mixing up the things wherever possible, I'm trying to bring in as many details as possible within one symbol. Simple program itself, one single program itself, I'm trying to make in multiple features discussed so that within less time we can learn more things. And wherever not possible, I'm asking you to go through some tutorials. Okay? So that is it for today. Let's meet tomorrow at 9:30 a.m. Bye-bye till then.
Okay, thanks, Akhil.
Thanks, Akhil. Have a good evening.
Did you receive the recording for yesterday's session?